Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is a scheduled meeting of Sunderland Board of Selectmen. And in addition, we have the Deerfield Board and the Whately Board minus Paul Newlin, who isn't available this evening. It's kind of the first time that we have had an opportunity to sit down together in probably almost a year plus to discuss South County EMS, which is the main reason that we're here today. We all on the same page about that?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we do a lot of things together, and you know, everything from the high school, and we have problems at the high school, I guess, with administration building. We got the senior center that at some point that we'd like to talk to you guys about, you know, if we got the best location for it. And Kip, I noticed in your, when you had talked about the senior center, the services, or more in particular, the facilities, if that's really the right condition for them or not. So we'd like to talk about that. But I guess tonight we're going to be talking about the South County EMS. In the meeting is in Sunderland. Whately had kind of requested the first go. We do have a number of people in the audience. I'd like right now the selectmen to have, I'd like to hear what's coming from them. If we have opportunity, we'll go to the audience as well for comment. I do want just to remind everybody, we don't, if possible, try not, if you could introduce yourself so Sherry can get the information for the minute. She doesn't know everyone, so if you could introduce yourself, that'd be greatly appreciated, and try to cover new ground as well. Okay, so we are in at 6:05. Jonathan, you want to start, since
sure.
Chair Whately?
Well, the Whately board had wanted to have this meeting because we all know that the three towns are at our best when we are communicating with each other, and we are at our worst collectively when we are not communicating with each other. And because the issue with South County EMS is a constant topic of conversation in all three towns, because there is an RFP out there, because people are going to have to start to make a variety of decisions, we just thought it was a good idea to make sure that we were all sitting down at the same table so we could have an honest and frank, that may be the same word, conversation about what we are collectively and individually thinking about next steps and how best to move forward, assuming that we want to collectively move forward. And I am making that assumption that everyone wants to figure out the best way to make South County EMS the best possible service. We talk a lot in Whately about how the three towns are receiving better emergency medical service than we have ever done before. And that is not a knock on any of the three systems that existed prior to the formation of the South County EMS. Just the realities of the numbers that are reported out of scams on a regular basis, it's phenomenal. And then anecdotally, it's better than any of us could have ever imagined. So if we can all agree to have an honest dialogue and keep the vitriol down a little bit, I think we're all going to be better off, and we're going to be able to move forward with whatever comes out of the RFP that is now due on the 3rd, I want to say, or the 2nd, or 2nd of June, and that's right around the corner. So thank you very much. I appreciate everyone's time, and I'll leave it back to you, Tom.
Okay. Do we want to go around the tables and talk about our thoughts on South County EMS, where we are now? Carolyn, do you want to start?
Well, I have a new board, and I'm one of three, and we have not been able to really discuss our position as a board. But I would say there is consensus on the board that we value the paramedic service, and we want our residents to have a paramedic level service that is the best that we possibly can be. And I don't know until the RFP comes back, you know, what and who responds to the RFP. I mean, we don't really have any information to pass on at this point as far as, you know, a decision or even general discussion. Ultimately...
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Do you think when the RFP comes back, and do you think that would affect the viability of South County EMS?
You mean when it... The RFP is coming back to the Board of Oversight.
Yeah.
That's correct.
The responses.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
The response. Do you... And I guess my question is, the reason, I think the reason why the RFP was put out was to try to take it's easy to talk about different things, but at some point the rubber has to hit the road, and the RFP is kind of that. And so you could suggest that you put the EMS at the Deerfield Elementary School, but and that's fine conversation point, but we all know what can happen. So when I look at the RFP coming back, I look at it, the South County EMS will continue. It's just we're going to make a decision where it's going to be next. That's how I look at it, I thought.
Yes, and I would say that that's pretty much where we're coming from, is that, you know, people can talk about what they want to do and where they want it, but the RFP is going to answer. It's transparent, it's open to anybody, and is certainly been out there long enough for, you know, people to respond to. So it will give us who is really interested, and we'll make a decision based on that.
Tom, could I ask a question?
Sure.
And it is a direct one, can anyone, because I can't, and I'll answer my own question up front. I can't for the life of me think of any scenario where after the scoring is done on all the responses, both from a financial perspective, because they're obviously opened separately, and from a content perspective, I can't think of a reason why I wouldn't say whatever the SCIMS Board of Oversight recommends as the location of South County EMS, whether it's in Waitley or it's in Deerfield or it's in Sunderland, if the scoring comes back to suggest that one location is the preferred location based upon the scale and rating that the SCIMS board put together with Doug, I guess, is there anyone else who thinks, who can imagine not heeding the recommendation of the SCIMS board?
I can say yes, because I'm new to this process, but from doing my own homework and hearing things, it seems that the service is fantastic, but, you know, nobody seems to want to address the money issue. And the money issue is an important thing, too. And so that, sitting on our board, I'm willing to look at all the proposals openly, but not going to commit to any one of them if I don't think that it's in the best interest of SCIMS and our communities.
But I'm hoping the scoring would make it be beneficial to South County as well as to each of our towns.
That would be my guess.
Yeah. I mean, the whole purpose of this is to be transparent.
Right. As opposed to a subjective look at,
right,
well, I really like this, this, or this, an objective analysis of what's in the best interest of the service and, more importantly, the residents of the three towns.
Right.
And this, then the objectivity, in my mind, trumps this any subjectivity that takes place outside of an RFP process.
I think we're going to have questions on the length of the choice, whether we have to go to town meeting or it can be a three-year selectman's decision. If it's longer than 3 years, then it has to go to town meeting. And then it becomes subjective. So I think that's important, a part of the RFP process is that it, you know, be a selectman's decision so that our board, as a board, can vote on it. But it's a three-year term, you know, and it can be renewable. But, you know, I think going to town meeting, it becomes subjective, and I think that's a fair statement to say.
Fair. Fair enough.
I mean, I'm just putting that out there.
Fair. I would, Kip, your statement answer, I thought, was a good one, and I'm glad that you put that out there. I think as far as the money side of it, I think that there are some people that have been misstating what's been going on. I think it's important that we have an honest look. We've asked the COG to do a financial study. Sherry, did you talk to them about that?
I did.
So I think they got some grant money that they're going to look. And I think when you have an opportunity to come to some of the South County Board of Oversight meetings in Travers, I hope you guys do come. You'll learn that what we're doing right now is we're still working on the original three-year plan, and it hasn't been defined. The money that's been put into it hasn't gone anywhere. It's still available. And I think after this third, because this is actually the third year, starting of the third year that's working, I think after the end of this, we as a whole are going to have a much better understanding of how it's working. And I can tell you that, in particular, that our receipts from the South County EMS are way higher than what we thought they were going to be. That's something that we can't figure out. Those are something that we have to guess. And as we get more time into it, we hope we'll do a better job. Travers?
Well, I was wondering when the, was there a meeting on Monday, last Monday? Last Thursday. So I haven't gotten any, I'd like to have knowledge of when the meetings are.
Yep.
I'd love to see agendas for them and just kind of get more involved in showing up at the meeting, knowing what's happening, when they're happening. I look on our website, I don't see them. It'd be great to be
absolutely
more an invitation sent out or a email sent to me saying when it is, so I could get better educated. Being new to the board, being new to politics, I'd love to, you know, got a lot to learn. So and this is a really sticky situation. It's a great service, and I'd like to see it continue, and I just want to be better educated on all those issues. The money, you know, how much money is sitting in reserves right now, it's a little concerning, but I know it's a three-year thing, and we could see how that's going to be spent, you know, some of it coming back to town, or the assessment's going to be less. Just get better knowledge of the whole process, because I am, you know, 2 weeks into this, so...
Absolutely.
That'd be great to be.
And we could spend the entire night tonight just talking about the last 2 years of finances and how the Board of Oversight was real cautious on how it spent money.
Right.
And didn't purposely try to spend too much to kind of work into it so that we wouldn't overspend. But I think that's water over the bridge. I think we have to look at how it's been running over the, you know, how it's been working over the last 3 years. Mm-hmm. And just like when you guys start looking at your first, when you do your first budget next year in the town of Deerfield, you're going to see that you're going to be given information from your treasurer that's going to show how, in your accountants, how certain accounts, you know, your local receipts have been generated over the previous 5 years, and you're able to make nice estimations on looking at your revenue that we weren't
really
able to do yet.
Right.
And I think as we go into more time, that information's going to be forthcoming to you. As far as the meetings, we will try to make sure. I mean, typically, I don't know why I don't get on the thing on the TV in Deerfield, but Zach usually gets the meetings posted in a timely fashion.
Okay.
We'll have to do, but typically our meetings are the third Thursday of the month. So typically, our meeting is the third Thursday of the month at the Sunderland Fire Public Safety Complex, and they start at 6 o'clock. So that's usually when we're there. Okay?
Could I ask for a... Maybe I'm going to put the dunce cap on, I guess, for a second. If someone could help me connect the serious issue of the finances of scams, absolutely important. You know, the surplus, the revenues, it's critically important. But I guess what I'm missing is, why is that topic of significance to the scoring of the RFP that's coming out? I see them as two very important issues, but they are absolutely separate. Again, maybe I'm just a dunce, but I see them as just not related to each other in terms of how one would impact the decision-making of another.
I had the same question, because while they're related, they are two entirely different sets of judgments.
So I'm not as big a dunce as I thought I was. No. Okay. Thank you, David.
There's a relation in terms of whatever you're paying, because the financial aspect of the RFP is how much you're going to pay for the space. And sure, that's part of the budget. But there should be no... They're two separate topics. Here's the budget. You discuss that. While this is an input to the budget, you have what we come up with as a presumably reasonable and fair scoring system, and then you abide by that for your RFP, like you would any RFP.
Were they connected? I didn't know they were.
Well, it seems like we were talking about the location, and then we transitioned into a discussion of the operating budget for scams and the receipts and the excess surplus or capacity or however you want to. And so I was, and I
actually,
and I've seen,
I don't think,
wait, and I've seen, I've seen and heard about communication that is inextricably linking the two together, and it's troubling to me because I don't see the connection. If SCIMS, and it's not the case, but if SCIMS from a finance perspective is being run into the ground, that needs to be addressed. And again, it's not the case, but it has nothing to do where those ambulances are housed on a nightly basis.
No.
Well, from my point of view, and most people here don't know me, but unfortunately, I have more than my fair share of rides in ambulances, and so haven't my children. And I know the importance of having great paramedics and stuff like that. And one could argue that we should have three ambulances, a staff of 20, and two of them have ER doctors, because that's the best thing. But there has to be a balance between protecting our citizens at a cost that is reasonable. Mm-hmm. And to answer your question is, if we get these RFPs back, and financially they're just not prudent decisions, you don't go with it just to have a place for the ambulance. It has to be a weight of balance. Yeah. You have to consider, you know, is any of the RFPs, you know, fall within line? Because, you know, I don't know what it's going to bring. And that's why my early statement is, you know, I don't want to feel obligated, and I'm not going to be obligated, to just choose one of whatever we get. There might be, you know, we might get two, or we might get 10, and maybe all 10 of them won't be, you know, in my mind, sufficient. And that, I think, would be a better time to have a discussion, because now it's all what ifs and we don't know.
No, that's very fair.
I appreciate that. I just want to make sure that the budget is it's not a red herring for a very important discussion about where
no,
this is located.
No, but it has to be part of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I think the first part of the rating criteria is kind of subjective, because you've got the, what, six or seven criteria, and you've got, what, three categories of how you're going to rate, but then each one of the seven is not weighted. They're all equal weight. So somebody's got to decide, well, which is more important if there's a tie, and how are you going to add up? What are you going to, you're going to assign 1, 2, 3 for each category, something to come up with a number? I guess I'm a little confused. How is that? How are you going to determine the best one based on them criteria without looking at the budget yet? But that's the first step, looking at them criteria. And maybe you're going to, I don't remember exactly what the outcome is of that process, whether you're gonna rate in order, 1, 2, 3, or pick the best three, and then look at the cost for the three and determine which is the best fit? I don't know. Is that discussed in the RFP, or how's that going to happen?
Fred, if I could, Doug. You didn't purposely put in a numerical scoring system. You just had advantageous, non-advantageous, right?
Right.
Was there a reason for that?
Highly and advantageous and non. I think there's three.
Right. There's advantageous, non-advantageous, and disadvantageous. The expectation is that the scoring will be developed by the Board of Oversight on their own.
Right.
To respond to the question, is this not subjective? It is entirely subjective. It is entirely up to the Board of Oversight to use their experience and their own best judgment as to whether or not a place will be more, will provide a greater, a lesser response time or a greater response time, and in their best judgment to score it, you know, accordingly. And if the Board of Oversight choose to assign numeric values to be able to come to a conclusion about any given proposal, that's certainly up to them. And they can choose to do that as they see fit. But they have to use those criteria to assess the proposals. That's all they have to do. They have to use those criteria to assess their proposals.
But has the Board of Oversight developed that?
We haven't talked about
methodology, how you're going to review and rank or rate?
We haven't talked about that yet.
Let me ask Doug a question. Who actually made the RFP? Wasn't it?
The RFP was developed as a merger of a couple of different previous models of RFPs. One was submitted to me by Tom. It was from a
town of Beverly.
There you go. They were looking for housing for their fire service vehicles. Another RFP was given to me by Sherry Patch. That came from, I'm trying to remember where that model
Hardwick.
Came from. Hardwick, okay. Again, for municipal building, at least municipal space. Between those two, the RFP was developed, modified and customized for this particular purpose.
Did the Board of Oversight review it and they were happy with it?
Submission?
No. Yeah.
Getting this submission out there as quickly as possible was
That was a question that we had at our last Board of Oversight meeting. Was the that never came back to the Board of Oversight for our review, and so we didn't know. We really didn't have an opportunity to review that. And at our meeting, Doug had basically said the same thing because of trying to get it out in a timely fashion. That's what he had set out the town of Deerfield.
I don't know that it would have made a big difference, but I personally would have liked to have seen the Board of Oversight review that. It seems in my short tenure that it seems like we put the cart before the horse because it's always a rush to do something, I don't see that why it needs to be that way.
I wish I could argue with you.
I would weigh in if I could that the town administrators and interim town administrators are much more skilled in developing an RFP than a volunteer Board of Oversight. That's what we pay them to do. It's my own two cents.
I'm not questioning him doing it.
No, I understand. I don't know what value
should have,
be brought.
You know, put in, because the question is how are they going to rate this? Now, if they get it's put in their hand to kind of look at this and say, well, you know, this is a scoring system that we have in place.
Sure.
You know, it's going to be kind of put on the back burner because they're going to hopefully use their best judgment
sure.
as to what needs to be done.
I would actually weigh in saying that's a great delineation that the scoring mechanism should be a really thoroughly vetted discussion with the Board of Oversight and the fiscal agent versus the crafting of the actual RFP.
Right.
So we're talking about, I think, the developing of the request and then the actual exercising of the decision.
Right.
Doug?
If I may just follow up on that. As I mentioned earlier, the criteria must be used to assess the RFPs.
Right.
There was no numerical values assigned to the scoring for that criteria. That allows the Board of Oversight the ability to independently weigh certain criteria over others. But the responses do have to be assessed according to that criteria. For example, maybe the top criteria is response time. They will weigh that more heavily than, say, the ability for the EMS to move in right away. maybe it'd be better to wait 6 months to move in for into a space that will have will prove to be better in terms of response time.
Well, and Doug, being someone who's written an awful lot of RFPs and also responded to an awful lot of RFPs, from a transparency perspective, after the decision is made, that scoring is going to have to be very open and upfront, because if it's not, it's going to open itself up to not just criticism, but
challenges.
But challenges.
Yeah,
and that's something that we want to, that the service wants to avoid.
Absolutely.
Good point.
Mm-hmm. So. Okay. Fred?
Yeah, I think you're reading in the papers, one of our concerns is, you know, we've got other interests in the building, in the space that we have, and keeping the RFP, I know it says 120 days, that's 4 months that we have to wait for a decision or to tell somebody else that we're interested in them. I guess we'd like to see that process accelerated if at all possible. I mean, don't wait till the 119th day to meet and decide. I guess if it comes a lot sooner, we would really appreciate that, because as you know, there's other interests in our building.
The only problem, Fred, when you've been around town as long as I have, is that you remember how Whiteley stole the town Frontier Administration from this very building to take him to Whiteley through an RFP process.
You got it back.
And how Whiteley gave us a building that needed $600,000 of work before they could do it. But I'm not going
it's
there.
It's Frontier.
But
it's not Whiteley. It's Frontier. It's looking. We're all part of Frontier.
But Mr. I just remember that thing. I says, well, after Whiteley's elementary school, came to me and says, well, geez, we have a building. Why isn't there an RFP to see if who gets the best deal? So I did kind of smile when, because maybe Sunderland's going to ask the same thing now, but the administration next time, hey, how come you don't do an RFP program and see maybe Sunderland has a better deal than Whiteley does?
Could be.
But to your point about timing, I agree with the sensitivity of it. I get it.
Well, and again, from a, never mind sensitivity about, I mean, I'm speaking personally, and I'm probably in the minority of my own board of selectmen on this one. Never mind other suitors. It's about if the SCIM's Board of Oversight has made the decision, and they certainly have, that finality to the ultimate location is in the best interest of long-term service delivery to the residents of the three towns, then that should be the driving force behind making a final decision about where SCIMS is housed, because the theory among the Board of Oversight members of SCIMS is that permanent housing and finality of this will be better for the service. So never mind who else is trying to date Whiteley. It's about service delivery. That's all we should be concerned about. Service delivery, service delivery, service delivery. Assuming that it meets the financial needs of the three towns. Yeah, so that's the expeditious need.
I would hope anybody that's attended a Board of Oversight meeting, the major points of discussion are centered around the service to the three towns. And we very, very seldom get into the politics, because Gary Stone was the in charge of the EMS and Whiteley. Bob was in charge of EMS in Sunderland, and Matt was basically in charge in Deerfield for part of the time. I can guarantee those three don't have time to play politics, because that's not near.
Couldn't agree more.
That's not in their wheelhouse. They want to provide a service.
Couldn't agree more.
I think if you look at it, if you look at the director. And I personally apologize to the director at our last meeting, because we don't want the director to ever, and I hope this is one thing that I'm glad we're all together, we don't want to put the director in the political sector. We want him to do his job. And the problems really have, if there are problems, especially political, they have to be directed more towards the Board of Oversight. The director, We don't want to do that to our chief of police or our fire chief or town administrators. The politics has to go with the Board of Oversight, not the director, because, I mean, he has a hard time getting all the shifts filled and making sure the ambulances are meet their codes and everything. So we just want to keep the politics out of it for him right now. Are we all set with so far with that? Do we want to go more on the? Would you like to add anything, Carolyn or Dave, Scott, on that? Are we okay with that?
Oh, absolutely. I
think we got a feel.
I know there has been criticism of the budget, but that was based on being conservative, and we get criticism. Our Deerfield Select Board gets criticism because we're conservative on our revenue, and so we have generate free cash. Well, we use free cash to cover our operating budget. It's not a good thing, but I still want to remain conservative on our revenue, and I agree with how you approached the setup of the ambulance. I know people are saying there's too much money, you've retained too much money, but people don't understand that, you know, we don't have enough experience yet, and I would rather be conservative because the money hasn't gone anywhere. I mean, you have it, and I think being conservative is smart. We said that this was going to be a three-year cycle. We committed to a three-year cycle, and I think we have to follow through on the three-year cycle before we start making adjustments to how we, you know, do the assessments. I mean, ultimately, I certainly hope our assessments, I mean, my goal was to see this ultimately break even somewhere down the line in a few years. But because we need all the cash we can to keep our operations going, our own operations. But I think being conservative as the Board of Oversight was your job. And I'm not going to criticize that at all.
Better that than the reverse.
Yes, absolutely. And you were conservative starting up, and, you know, in hindsight, maybe, you know, with our revenue stream the way it is, you could have been maybe not so conservative. But I'm not going to criticize that. So, and I think if people are truly interested, they need to go to the Board of Oversight meetings, and they need to sit there and listen to the variables. You don't know who is going to be sick. I mean, Kibbe was just talking about riding on the ambulance, but who is riding on the ambulance? Who has private insurance? Who has Medicare? Who, you know, how many times are they actually making the runs? Our runs were estimated, and we're meeting the runs, but you know, you don't want people to be sick in your community either. So,
You know, Carolyn, it's funny you should say that, but you go back when you talk about the way the budgets are. When we were the very first budget and looking at the three-year cycle, Obamacare was just coming into,
and that played a huge factor.
No one knew the impact. How that was going to impact.
I know.
And that was the shot in the dark. We had no idea what was going to happen. And that was one of the weak points in our plan was that. But I mean,
people forget that. And that was a huge consideration at the time. And people forget that played a fact in how we did the formulas and stuff like that. You know, what were we going to generate for assessments? So, I'm not going to criticize. And I hope our communities will work together because we're actually having success. So it's hard to complain.
Good point.
Yeah, good. Either you or Doug explain the process. Once I understand, the Board of Oversight is going to review all the responses to the RFP and make a recommendation to the fiscal agent, who's the town of Deerfield, and then what happens after that? What's the next step?
We'd have to enter into a contract with the. I guess it depends on the IMA, and I guess that probably what we should talk about next is the IMA and the setup of the IMA. I believe, according to what our town council says, Sherry, he basically, if I'm not, he already believes that the Board of Selectmen have. And each of the towns have the authority to
enter into an IMA without town meeting.
Yeah, and so I don't know. I don't know what each town wants to do, you know. Okay,
but after the fiscal agent takes an action, does it come back to each town to take an action on that or agree to that?
So right now in our IMA, it's written in our IMA, and I just read it the other day. I think this is it right here. It's written that we'd have an ambulance in the South Deerfield Fire District. We'd have an ambulance station there, Sunderland, and in Whiteley. Is that right, Bobby? So I would believe in the IMA then says that for any major changes, it needs to go to the town meeting vote.
Town meeting in each of the towns.
Yeah. In each of the towns, correct.
Okay. So if we're changing...
Huh?
But the IMA also states, and this is subject to council opinion, that the boards of selectmen can change the IMA through majority vote.
Yeah, and that's something that that we would talk. I think we'd have to sit down. That'd have to be in my opinion, that would have to. I'm just speaking for myself. We'd have to sit down and decide how we want to do that.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Would you agree with that?
Mm-hmm. So it's either each board of selectmen or each town meeting would vote on the location.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think you can go both ways. I think personally, when we originally had talked, we said it was going to go back to town meeting vote, right? So I think that's I'm kind of like, if I say something, I kind of like to follow through with what I say.
Okay.
Maybe the next gyration of our IMA, we would put it down that we wouldn't have to do it, but I think we told our people that if we were going to move it, we would come back to town meeting.
So if we want to change the IMA, we need to do that soon.
Correct.
Well, but I think what Tom's saying is that he wouldn't want to change the IMA before this ultimate decision of housing because it's what we promised to the voters when we originally sold the skims to the individual towns.
That's how I would feel. And again, I haven't polled Scott or David, or I don't know if you guys have talked about it. I mean, that's...
Yeah, but I would agree.
The location never didn't really come up in Whateley that much. It was just...
I think when we had informational, Gary, is that right? When we had informationals, we kind of talked about going back for town meeting vote, didn't we?
Yes.
So, and I think in our informational hearings, that's, and again, we, and to tell you the truth, I would think if it goes through the Board of Oversight and our fiscal agent, they're all making the recommendation of a certain facility. I would hope at that point we would be able to have a fair discussion at town meetings.
Right. And it would either be recommended by or not recommended by the board.
Absolutely.
Select.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. So, Travers, have you an opinion on that?
I agree with that. I mean, it sounds...
Kip?
Mm-hmm. I'm taking it in.
I know. Yeah. I know it's new for you. Fred, what do you think?
Yeah, okay. I guess if that's the way... I'm not arguing to change it. I just wanted to understand and make sure we all knew what it was going to...
No, that's good. I like that was a good question.
And I think it's a fair... I don't think it should be anything that we should be afraid of. The town of Whateley passed the IMA like 100-5. The town of Sunderland passed it about the same. And the town of Deerfield, it passed by about 100-10. And I'm not exaggerating that dramatically there. I mean, it was overwhelming all through the town, so...
However, our special town meeting was not in favor of us moving it. So
resolutions,
I know that
are different
was much
than
smaller.
Binding, but yes, you're right.
But so there has been some pushback in the town, and we have to be cognizant of that and try to take in as much information as we can.
That was a voice vote, of course.
Correct. Yeah,
right,
correct.
So.
And that's why it's important to have information.
Right.
Because
quite
honestly, people want paramedic service, and they want it when they... pick up the phone and dial 911. So
I do think it's funny because the two people, not knowing where everybody lives here, Mark, you're excluded because you live way out in the Yahoo land, but of all the people in this room, Carol and I are probably the most affected because of where we live.
Good point.
And I think we've been pretty consistent of what and again, when you look at the maps, and to me, it's simple. When you look at the maps that were generated in the Baxter report, we kind of know exactly. You know, you could probably put any one of us could put a pin in, and you're going to always get a little, because Carolyn, you're going to kind of be in the red no matter where it is, except if they move it down by the auction house. Mm-hmm. But Carolyn's always going to be in the red, and we just make more red if it's in Sunderland than if it's in Whiteley or Deerfield, and less red if it's kind of like right at the intersection. I mean, we see the charts.
But I think what's important here is to remember what we had. We had a basic service that you might have had to wait. I would have had to wait maybe an hour for, or 40 minutes or 50 minutes. So if I have to wait 14 minutes for paramedic level service, that's pretty darn good.
Right.
And if what more is a concern for me is that if our first ambulance is busy, I have the second ambulance ready, because I don't want to wait an hour. I want the second ambulance to come in 16 minutes or 18 minutes. So I think
those are high numbers.
Yes, but I am on the Greenfield line, and I am the furthest away. So, but those to me is what's important to me as a resident, as you know, a board of selectmen. I want to know what we are spending to make sure that we cover, you know, the majority of our residents in a reasonable time and all that kind of stuff, and it's a reasonable cost. But if you're making it personal, I would like to make sure that second ambulance is coming as well. And that is really important, because there is no other coverage for nobody else is coming. And that's what people forget also, is that there is a Greenfield ambulance, but it covers so many places that it's usually not available. So
you want to hear something good? At our last meeting, we signed an agreement with the facility up in Compion Greenfield that we provide intercepts for them now. Our unit is growing with a dependability where other places are now
coming to
us and asking for help.
I know.
So we thought that was
very cool. Yeah.
We thought that spoke volumes about the service. Mm-hmm. And we're only in our second year.
I know.
And I think we're going to do better stuff as we move along.
I agree.
But Fred, that was actually good. That was an excellent question. Thank you.
Okay.
That was a good question. I don't know if we have a real answer.
You answered it, because I think now I better understand, and hopefully everybody here understands how that's going to work.
Right, okay. Just the mechanics of the process.
Yeah.
I like important. That. Yeah. And I think that was part when we asked Doug before, the mechanics of how the RFP works also. I think that's and unfortunately, I don't know how you get away from the subjective part of it.
Right. You need that's in there.
But it's a transparency.
Right.
Right. It's not
really.
Right.
And it's not. And maybe it is subjective versus town meeting being subjective, but I don't look at it being subjective, because I think you're being consistent and you're putting the criteria out, and it's 100% consistent, and it's being professionally.
There's a difference when it's professionally laid out, like the scam. And again, you mentioned, you know, these three guys who have been superstars, were superstars before, and they've been superstars since scam started. These criteria are laid out. Subjectivity becomes more objective when it's coming from people who know what they're talking about and are professionals, and their ethics are on the line. The subjectivity comes in when it's someone like me or you who have no background or experience on emergency management service delivery. So that's when it becomes very subjective. And then it's just like, I'm going to toss a coin, I really want it in Sunderland because, you know, that's where I... Whatever the reason is, it becomes more objective when people who really have a track record of knowing what they're talking about in that profession have put together criteria, and they're going to weigh the different responses. So that really is more objective. But Carolyn, you're right, it's transparency as well.
It's the transparency of it, right. And the consistency on how you're judging the proposals.
I know there's one other thing that we wanted to talk about, but do we need to talk any more about the RFP process?
No, are you okay? I'm thrilled that we've had the communication.
Travers, Kip, are you guys okay?
Yep.
Fred?
Fine.
Yeah.
Scotty?
Yep.
David, Carolyn? Comments from the audience? Yes, sir.
Bruce Hunter, resident of Deerfield. I just wanted to verify the process. I think we should discuss it in from step one to step the final step. The RFPs will be received by the town. They'll be submitted to Boo for review.
Yeah. And
Boo will make a recommendation to the Board of Selectmen of Deerfield.
Yep.
Deerfield will make a recommendation to the other two boards.
Yes.
And then a town meeting vote will happen in all three communities. Is that correct?
Something.
Yeah. That's as I understand it pretty much, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, now the recommendation may go to all three towns, but Deerfield, as the fiscal agent, has the next step in terms of moving the process along.
Yeah. Right.
Well, they can say now it's
doing it. Any town technically could, but yeah.
So could
the stop it.
Right.
Yeah. It could, absolutely. Is that it, Bruce?
Yes, thank you.
Chair, did we capture that?
We did.
Excellent. Thank you for the summation. That was good, Bruce. Any other questions? Okay. We had a short discussion about the IMA and changes. Something was sent around the other day. Doug sent it forward. Did you want to hit the high points, Doug?
Sure. Based on what I've just heard tonight, it sounds like this is something that will likely wait until after this decision about housing has been concluded. However, the changes that were proposed to the IMA were the result of a conversation that started with Zach Smith, who had been looking at a couple of things, and he said, hey, do you think we can get this done? Do you think we can get that done? And I said, sure, that sounds great. Is there anything else? And he said, are you kidding? And I said, no, really, you know this service and you know the agreement probably better than anyone. What would you suggest? And then he went through with a red pencil and created a number of red line changes that he would recommend. I took a look at those changes. I added a few of my own. And what the result of is the document you have in front of you, or the document that hopefully all of you have seen. Many of them, I would say two-thirds of the recommended changes, are simply wordsmithing. For example, making sure that the fiscal agent is consistent all the way through. In some parts of the document, it referred to the town of Deerfield, when really referring to the fiscal agent was more appropriate. This allows for greater flexibility for renegotiation of the IMA later on. If another town takes the lead, then you simply change the definition of who the fiscal agent is. The rest of the document stays the same. It makes it easier. In some cases, some of the language was, there's, you know, literally punctuation and grammar changes. The largest changes that are in there are the result of a recommendation from Zach Smith, where he recommended removing the references to location whatsoever. They are listed as the primary facility, the secondary facility, and the backup facility, I think. Mm-hmm. In the document, they don't mandate that the service operate out of those locations. Those locations are mentioned only in reference to the financial responsibility of the South County EMS when it comes to making renovations or repairs to whatever space they are in. It refers to the South Deerfield Fire Station, for example, saying that the primary location of the South Deerfield Fire Station, the EMS service will be responsible for repairs and updates to the space that it has within the station, but the South Deerfield Fire Department will be responsible for changes, upgrades, or repairs to the larger building and the outside envelope of the building, like the roof, windows, things like that. It simply sets up the financial responsibility of the EMS in terms of repairs and upgrades to whatever space they're in. Zach recommended simply removing the reference to the locations, which cleans up that piece of language. Instead, now it says, if the EMS is going to lease a space, the EMS shall only take on the financial burden of repairs to the space within which they operate, and shall not take on any financial burden for exterior or other space considerations. Now, in the IMA, it does say that a change in location must be voted by all three town meetings. The IMA does not say where the service operates out of. It really doesn't. It doesn't say the service shall operate principally out of the South Deerfield Fire Department. As a matter of fact, other than listing those three locations in the terms regarding financial lease, or financial responsibility, the only only place in the document where the word location is used is when it says changes to location must be approved by town meetings in all three member in all member towns. It's kind of ridiculous. We have also spoken with our legal counsel in Deerfield. She has confirmed that as an intermunicipal agreement, this agreement is outside of the provisions of Chapter 30B. It may be negotiated exclusively by the executives in the towns. It may be negotiated for a term longer than 3 years. And it does not require, broadly speaking, an IMA does not require town meeting approval. That being said, when this IMA was crafted, they put in those terms, a change in location or the addition of a member town shall require town meeting approval. Whoever crafted this IMA said, we're going to town meeting for either of these two things. You basically gave away your right to negotiate those two things independent of town meeting.
Okay. Yeah. So that's it. And I think we were all on board with that. Yeah. When we had the town meeting, sure.
Absolutely.
The one other change, and it may be simply semantics, but I just want to make sure about who votes what portion of the budget. I believe that's a change, but I could be wrong about that. In terms of the fiscal agent votes the entire budget and the other two towns only vote their share of the budget. I believe, again, I could be wrong. It originally said all three towns vote the whole budget. Is that not?
Let me look over Trevor's shoulder here.
Yeah, you're specifically referring to the comment that
SF15, I believe.
Where's the budget?
And then how that relates back to the approval section under item C, because it does tend to contradict it, the comment and the approval section.
The comments on the right-hand side basically was me to clarify with legal counsel, or with Zach, more to the point. This is Article 4, Section 1. It says, South County EMS is, for fiscal purposes, deemed a department of the town of Deerfield. All expenses are subject to appropriation by the town of Deerfield and the designated contributions from or behalf of the towns of Sunderland and Whately. By making it a department of the town of Deerfield, that makes the EMS subject to all the requirements that any other department must meet. It must go before the Finance Committee for a recommendation. Capital purchases must be approved by, or must be recommended by the Capital Improvements Plan Committee. And it must be, and the approval of the budget must go before the town meeting and be approved by town meeting. The budget per se does not have to be approved by Sunderland and Whately. All that Sunderland and Whately have to do is approve their appropriation.
Though we could vote the whole thing.
And we would certainly hope you could, you
right.
would, and you
right.
can
okay.
you know, make it transparent, sure. But it only requires Deerfield to approve the budget.
So is that saying that the fiscal agent will always be the town of Deerfield regardless of location?
No.
No.
And
it's whoever wants to do it.
The Baxter report went over and looked at had discussed the different methods that we could use for governance of the South County EMS. It was felt, and that having a fiscal agent, one of the towns become the fiscal agent, would be in our advantage because it would be less expensive than trying to do it by ourselves. And I think we got what, $57,000 from the town of Deerfield, I think, for the. I think 57, right? That 57,000 is probably for the fiscal agent of running South County EMS is probably cheaper than if we try to do it on our own. You know, when you look at all the, you know, you hire one person, you're gonna, with benefits, you're going to be 57,000. The town of Deerfield, at the time, had four EMS paramedics, five, something like that. Probably remember what it was. They already had four full time. Sunderland had one at this present time. Whately didn't have any at that full time.
No full time.
And it was felt that it would be easier to dovetail, because we had all those four people that were already there, it'd be easier to dovetail into Deerfield as the fiscal agent. Just kind of like with the senior center, the fiscal agent, and again, it was going to be South County, senior center was going to be in the Deerfield building. It was just easier to use Deerfield as a fiscal agent. And the other thing is, when you looked at the benefits that are offered to the employees, Deerfield is right in the middle. Whiteley is a little bit better, Sunderland's a little bit less. And Deerfield is kind of like mama bear in the middle. You got the papa and the baby. And so they're just kind of, so it's felt that that would be the fairest to the employees that were presently there also.
So that will continue regardless of.
Yeah, unless Deerfield doesn't want to do it, or there's a reason not to do it.
Or we could always have a conversation. I mean, if Sunderland wanted to do it, they could, they, you know, Sherry could call Doug and say, hey, you want to put this on an agenda to have a conversation, and that's always possible. I, for the life of me, I can't imagine why anyone would want to be the fiscal agent, but, you know.
I would say over the last 2 years, the biggest thing I learned is that being the fiscal agent, you have to learn how to be the fiscal agent. That's the hardest part. Learning how to be the fiscal agent is a hard thing. And just because there's stuff that you're not used to doing, that all of a sudden become your responsibility.
Okay.
And I think it's hard, but once you learn how to be the fiscal agent, it gets easier.
Tom, could I bring up one other change to the IMA that I would like?
Sure. Well,
I'm sorry.
No, I was going to say that. So this was the proposed. Were coming from Zach and reviewed by the town of Deerfield administrator, interim town administrator. Maybe what we should do is over the next couple weeks take a look at it, and if there's any other changes, add it to. And we really should schedule another meeting anyways. I would say maybe this time in Deerfield if you want, or Sunderland or Whiteley. But maybe by that time we can have some of the results starting to come back, and we can start talking about that.
Sure.
So I mean, if anybody wants to continue talking about the IMA, that's good.
Yeah.
But I think we should just put everything on the table and talk to it all together.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Yes, sir.
A couple comments on the IMA if we're going to be discussing that. One of the things I brought forward at one of the Deerfield meetings, and I'm not sure that I have the latest and greatest changes, but your effective date of the IMA goes from January to January to January, and yet you want to change, but yet everything else is referred to the fiscal year. So as long as you're doing things, it may be one something you want to adjust.
Great, got that one.
Okay. The other thing is there is changing the terms of membership to 2 years. I guess if I were doing it, I wouldn't. If I want to replace everybody all at once, you might want to stagger those terms. Mm-hmm. If you're going to get into that,
you know, I think when we first, that those are good points, Doug. If we could put that in also, I think that's what we, Bobby, didn't we first start talking about that, about staggering after we got up and running? And I think maybe we haven't got.
I'm not sure that I had.
No, I think we had talked about it, but we've never addressed it. And that's a good point. That's a good point. And Doug's probably going to write that down, so we'll remember to talk about that. But we thought it would be staggering would be a good idea also.
It's something that I brought up at a meeting of the Board of Oversight of SCIMS, I don't know, a month ago, maybe now or something. Currently, and this is regardless of how many representatives serve on a Board of Oversight. It can be 15 to 1 to 1. It doesn't matter. But I think to make, because we're all very busy people, and people on the Board of Oversight are busy people serving on a lot of committees. They have families, they have jobs, what have you. That attached to every member of the Board of Oversight should be an alternate. So that if somebody gets busy and has to miss a meeting, that the town doesn't lose a vote because that person was busy. So if Tom Feidenkevitz, who's on the Board of Oversight representing Sunderland, is missing, then Joe Sixpack gets that vote instead, so that, again, there's never a situation where the town of Sunderland is underrepresented when a vote has to take place.
And I would encourage that sooner rather than later, just because there are going to be a lot of votes coming up over the next several months. Mm-hmm. And none of us, I know I don't want the town of Deerfield or the town of Sunderland or the town of Whately underrepresented in these votes or these discussions. And the alternates would have full ability to interact and communicate during discussion. We want to make sure that all towns are represented fully during communication, during votes, and what have you. And I think that would solve that issue.
Interesting point. May I just ask for clarification? Are you asking for one alternate for each town?
No, one alternate per member. Per member. Per member. Because it may seem like overkill, Doug, but it ensures that all towns are always represented, and not only just in votes, but just in dialogue. I mean, this conversation has been tremendous, and I know that the SCIMS Board of Oversight has similar conversations. Shame on us if, in our busy lives, we don't accommodate people who can't make it, so then one town is underrepresented in a critically important conversation.
Well, the only thing I can say, Bruce has been to some of our meetings, and if we don't have a town represented, we don't conduct business. So, I mean, that's been our policy.
And sometimes you may want. I'm
just saying that's been our policy. We don't. And I know some people use the term lovey-dovey, Mr. Pachurik. But in fact, it is that we have a lot of these guys, Bobby and Matt and Gary and these guys have all worked in situations that we would never even want to put ourselves in. They have, and they have an understanding, and it is, we have had meetings where we have had a town not represented, and we don't conduct business because of that.
Right, and this could save that. I mean, it's just
that's fine.
Something to chew on.
Yeah, that's fine. I don't have a problem with that.
May I ask, is that just an informal rule that the Board of Oversight adopted?
If the chair right now is Bobby, if we don't have a representative from a town, we won't conduct business like that.
Okay.
We just don't think it's fair.
That's the beauty of strong partnership.
Yeah, I'm not objecting to it at all. I was just curious.
That's just how we do stuff.
Would there be an objection to making that part of the rules set up in the IMA that In the absence of all members of any given town, that no business can be conducted.
And that's something we can talk about.
And it mirrors, and again, I started this all by saying that when we all communicate, we're at our best, and when we don't, we're at our worst. And it exactly mirrors the relationship we have with the South County Senior Center. If one of the three towns is not represented in a meeting, we don't meet. And we go our separate ways. We go have a drink, whatever it is, but we don't meet because communication's the golden egg here.
Okay, so we want to have another meeting on the IMA in a couple weeks.
Yeah, Carolyn, that's fine.
Did we want to, you want town administrators to set a meeting up?
Yes, that would be great. I think we should probably have a meeting after the RFPs come in.
Sure.
Right. So,
that could be good timing.
Yeah. So we'll just let the town administrator set up something. Okay.
Does any of our towns need to go to special before the end of the fiscal year? Are we all done with our town meeting?
We're having a special meeting on June 6th, but I mean, we'll have another one.
Okay.
It's not a big deal.
We're not having one to the fall.
Okay. Travers?
That's good.
Yep. Anything you add? Thank you, gentlemen, for nice meeting you. Congratulations on your becoming part of the process.
Oh,
happy.
Dan.
Yes, sir.
Dan Dennehy. Lately, I'm just wondering where we stand on the replacement ambulance. I'm kind of concerned we're wearing out our primary, and I hadn't heard whether we were replacing or not.
Bobby?
They'll be replacing it this coming fiscal year.
Another year.
This year.
Well, this year.
It's in this fiscal year.
July 1st.
So it's been appropriated.
Appropriated.
Got it. Wait for July 1st.
So you're going to take the blue and white one out? Do your Whately's go out? Is that what the plan is?
Sunderland's old ambulance will go in third. Whately's will go away.
Okay.
Deerfield's will go second.
And it's probably not going to be a big one like the Deerfield right now? Yeah, Zach.
Zach and company comes up with Nexus. Yeah,
They haven't told us what they're looking for right yet, so. Any other questions? Thank you for showing up tonight. Nice meeting you guys. Fred,
you thank you.
Carolyn.
Thank you for hosting.
Travers.
Appreciate it.
No. Hey, we got to be here anyways.
Meeting tonight?
Yeah, it's our meeting night.
Oh.
So we'll let you go on to business of the town of Sunderland.
Yeah. Thanks, guys. All right, minutes from May 16th, 17th, and 18th. Let's do the 16th first.
Motion on those.
We have a motion on the 16th. Minutes.
Second.
A motion made and seconded. All those in favor? This was our interview with Jane Jalbert. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
3-0. Sherry, minutes from May 17th. This was our interview with Chief
Demetropoulos.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion to accept the minutes.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And it's a wonder to have a town administrator that keeps us out of trouble.
Yep.
Pronouncing names is very important. Thank you, Sherry. Next up, we have the minutes from May 18th. And this is with Chief Harding from on his night.
Motion.
I'll second.
Motion made and seconded on the interview, Chief Harding. All those in favor, acceptance, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, we are done with that. Next up, Board of Selectmen updates?
I have none.
None this week?
Okay.
Yeah.
Town Administrator Scott?
I was going to say we should, under updates or under old business, about the next steps with respect to the chief's selection, timing, etc.
We'll talk that when we get to him.
Got it.
We're going to talk about that. I don't see it on the thing, but we'll talk about that.
Updates, I would think, yeah.
Town Administrator updates?
Just a couple. The solar project, I need you to vote to enter into contract with Kearsarge pending town council review. Contracts are being reviewed by Kearsarge now, and these contracts were previously reviewed by Copelman and Page.
Okay. Motion?
Oh, I'll make a motion, I guess.
Let's say it's a long slog. You better make it.
I guess we'll do it. You know.
Okay. Second.
Motion made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Zero.
Downstairs to sign, Sherry?
Yes.
Great, thank you.
Summer schedule? Do you have a recommendation?
I did draft for you a recommendation for our summer schedule.
There we go. Mm-hmm. You want me to read it?
Go ahead.
All right. This is from Sherry Patch, our town administrator. I recommend that the Board of Selectmen hold regular meetings according to the following 2016 summer schedule. June 6th and June 20th, July 11th and July 25th, August 8th and August 22nd, with weekly meetings resuming on September 12th. That's on paper anyway.
Okay with me.
Motion.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. It's a point of clarification.
You know, it's tough. It's almost Margaret, I can't remember, it said Sherry.
Yeah.
Sherry 3-0.
If I could expand on that, this includes offices downstairs as well?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep. proposed complete streets policy.
Why would we do this, Gary? Complete streets. Why would we do this?
It's a good idea.
There you go.
So again, Chair, this is a policy. It's part of the process with regard to
the community compact.
Right. Mm-hmm. So we vote this policy. It's a milestone in our process. We've mm-hmm. had a group working on this for a whole host of reasons and with a great deal of energy. And then the policy here gets us to that next step in the compact business.
So do you want to look at this week, or do you want to wait till next week after you had a chance to review this?
No, I think this is ready to go. Sherry's put a fair amount of energy and effort into it.
We've had a working group that met and looked at it. We reviewed policies from a few other towns. I looked at the transportation section of the town's master plan, and the policy that's being recommended is consistent with what's outlined in the transportation portion of the master plan as well. So I feel like it's a good policy.
So,
and actually, let me just go back, Scott. I thought your question was rhetorical as opposed to...
it was actually a softball.
It was, yeah. Not only is it a good idea, but in fact, because it has really been the direction that I think transportation planning has been going for the last 10 years or so, and Massachusetts in general, I think, has done a really good job of really putting some effort behind complete streets and making sure that as different kind of transportation projects are completed, that they think about all the different modes of transportation and how people might want to do it. And the policy that you've got in front of you it certainly provides the opportunity for the decision-making body within town, the select board, to make specific choices and decide not to make certain investments when they might not be in the best interest. But it really creates a very valuable dialogue and an expectation within the community that when you're performing different projects that you will, in fact, consider all different forms. So not only is it a good idea and the right thing to do relative to diverse transportation options, but it's also got a little bit of money associated with it, and so that may create an opportunity for us to get some resources that otherwise we wouldn't have.
Good point. In that process, we have a fair amount of exposure to newer thinking around transportation, whether it's aging in place, whether it's sidewalk design, whether it's cycling, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And the policy only spells out the stakeholders and the path. It's not project specific.
Yeah.
So that's really important part of it as well.
I think sometimes what's lost in having a historical remembrance of when administrations come and go. Administrations like to bring incentives to bear to try to accomplish their ideas. Mm-hmm. With Paul Cellucci, when he was governor, he had the EO 418, mm-hmm. an executive order 418, and we were jumping through hoops like you wouldn't believe. We had to jump through hoops for EO 14, and we always felt that we were three or four steps behind, and we were. But that's how his administration tried to put forward his mm-hmm. ideas. Not to say it was good or bad. It just little towns, smaller towns, it's very hard to keep hopping.
Isn't it so much like the conversation that you had in the chief interviews around community policing and how at one point there was money associated with community policing? Each of you commented on how over time it became part of the culture, that the money went away, but in fact it had affected the change. And I think this is probably likely to follow that same path, that where we are now, there's some financial incentives to get it done. But I would say 20 years from now, we would look back and say, of course, this is what we do. And the money may not still be there, but in fact, the cultural change, the thinking has evolved by that time, and it's a more inclusive approach to transportation planning.
And actually what you said is 100,000% true. And we saw that happen in Boston where a gentleman from one of the towns back east wanted to put stop signs up. I think it was stop signs, right?
It was a stop sign at an intersection.
And he kept saying, well, how can I do it with this community compact? I want to put stop signs up. and they kept saying, you can, but to put up those stop signs, we want to make that a quote-unquote safe intersection, and to do that, these are you may be stop signs, but you have to have the widths and bicycles, and you have to consider bicycles, pedestrians, cars, motorcyclists. We want all of that to be considered on that intersection, not just put up stop signs. And you're right. It may bring us to looking at projects differently. Instead of just using Chapter 90 money to put up stop signs, maybe we'll look at the whole and say, how are we going to make that a safer intersection for everybody, not just cars, but bikes and pedestrians, et cetera. So actually, a very, very good point, Gary. Excellent point. But I think it's more going back to, it's like the EO 418, and I think every governor has had their own way to go about it. Sherry, for our good fortune, has been on top of this since day one, and kind of typically by the time we got involved before, just like green communities, we kind of lose because we don't have a lot of people. Sherry's got us on pretty quick, got us up to speed. So, and again, we said it before, and I'll say it 100,000 more times. Sherry's got us early into the thing. So she's taken classes, David's taken classes, and that's part of the whole thing. So we're doing well. So if you think we're all set?
I think we're all set for the policy.
David, you think
the policy? So. Yeah, I think, and it's perfect union of timing, too.
Okay.
With the projects and everything that's going on. So.
And do I accept the motion, then?
Motion.
I'll second the motion to adopt the policy for complete streets as it's printed, recognizing we can always amend it.
Yep, exactly.
Okay, we have a motion made and seconded. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. A lot of people don't know, inside the white binders are all those policies over the years, and they have adopted date, amended date. Oftentimes, they're not the same dates. We go back and revisit. They're living documents.
Yep. Sherry, that's 3-0. Next up is seasonal highway employee recommendation. Davey?
Yes, here we go. This is from George Emery, our highway superintendent, dated May 23rd. Please appoint Nicholas York as seasonal summer help for the highway department. Sincerely, George Emery.
Motion.
Motion to appoint seasonal help as recommended by the superintendent.
Second.
All those in favor of Nicholas York as seasonal summer help, please signify by saying aye.
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 Sherry, 3-0, please.
While we're on highway, just one more update for you. Eddie Skribiski submitted his notice of intent to retire effective June 30th today. So I just wanted to make the board aware of that.
Well, thank you.
Congratulations.
6:30? Is George going to be
advertising? I started pulling the correct advertisement together. Okay. For his review, yep, in the boards.
Right, got it.
Okay. So, we haven't seen the letter, but...
It just came this afternoon.
Okay.
I haven't.
So there's not a lot we do.
Yep.
Can you, Sherry, talk to Ed and
sure.
Make sure he talks to the right people with Franklin County?
Yep, already started that.
Thank you. And again, sometimes just navigating it, and,
sure.
And if you can give them any help, would you?
Absolutely.
Thank you. Yeah. Next up is plumbing inspector employer appointment.
This is from Steve Baranowski, dated Wednesday, May 18th. To whom it may concern, I accept the position of the interim plumbing and gas inspector for the town of Sunderland. Respectfully, Stephen Baranowski.
Motion to appoint.
Motion.
I'll second that.
A motion made and seconded. All those in favor? Well, any discussion?
No. He's been the alternate, so.
Scott used to be a electrical inspector, so.
That's true.
He knows all these fun things that come along with town inspections. All those in favor of appointment of Stephen Baranowski as plumbing inspector, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, we're all set. Before we go, I'd just like to have a brief discussion about next step forward with the police chief. After having a few days to think about it, Scott, David, where do you want to go?
Process wise?
Yeah.
We have still got in the post screening committee, post interviews, post notes compilation, and some time to digest our conversation with the candidates. We also know that there's other steps that have got to happen. None of those steps are really going to happen without putting a name forward, I think.
Right.
You know, at at the risk of not wanting to seem like we're jumping the gun, we had three really qualified candidates that were brought forward to us. And I appreciate all of the background checks, screening work. But in many ways, the harder discussions start when you say, Tom, we'd like to talk to you about being blank.
And
negotiations actually go about beginning.
That's a hard part.
So I'm actually of the mindset that the sooner we make, the sooner we actually announce and begin those negotiations, the better off we're going to be. We've been half a year already.
So can we ask that next Monday night be dedicated to a discussion of that process of determining who to put the appointment forward?
Mm-hmm. June 6th?
I was going to say, did we just vote? No. If we're going to meet next Monday, we got to make sure we're meeting next Monday.
On Tuesday. Next Tuesday.
Next Tuesday makes sense.
Tuesday.
Special meeting makes sense.
Yeah. We'll talk about next Tuesday. Okay? And I would hold everything else, unless there's a major something for us to talk about, but I would keep the agenda clear of everything except for that, if possible.
That makes sense.
And if there, could you please give me a call if you have something that you think needs to go on? Could you just give me a call so we can review it?
Okay. No, I think that makes good sense.
David, okay?
Yeah.
Gary, any thoughts? You saw a lot of the interviews. What do you think? Were you?
Yeah, I saw two of them. Didn't see the third one. Mm-hmm. Had another commitment to stand up. But I think Scott just summed it up pretty well. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Think about.
Okay. Anything else tonight?
I don't think so. So Tuesday, do you want to post for 6?
Are you with that?
Yeah, I mean, if we're only going to talk about the candidates, we can do it at 6.
And should be 6 o'clock?
Chris can be home by 9.
Or so.
Or so.
A.M.
Pacific time anyway, at least.
Right? Like it.
Right. Yeah, 6 next week.
Yep,
that's fine. So before we gavel out, I just want to remind everybody that...
Friday.
Graduation of high schools is coming up. And I know there's many, many, many Frontier and surrounding town seniors listening to this right now. but maybe we'll get one or two grandmothers or grandfathers. But I just want to remind all of you that your mom, dad, and family are so super proud of you on the great accomplishment. And I think graduating from high school is a great accomplishment for all of us. It is that one step that's almost universally you have to do today to succeed in our world and our economy. I just like to remind you that go out, have a wonderful time, but just remember your moms and dads and the family that loves you, and they want you to be with them for a long time in the future. Think about those two little guys on the left and right shoulders in the white and the red. And for at least graduation night, please listen to the white, the guy on the shoulder.
Be careful.
That's telling you to do the good thing, the right thing. Listen to that person or that side of your shoulder. And for people, please remember also that these young men and women are graduating. It's a very important time in their lives. And if you see them, give them an attaboy or an attagirl, because it is an important time. And while we may have forgot what it was like to graduate, I remember. I think most of us do remember. So I would say enjoy that period. If you see them, give them a pat on the back and tell them the job well done. Also, this Friday night, Sunderland has a Memorial Day parade. 6 p.m. is a step off of the thing. I just like to remind people that they haven't been to the grammar or the town office building. We do have a short ceremony in the Memorial Park where there is a laying of a wreath, and also presentation of arms. So I would invite everybody to attend that. And I'm sure also the usually the Firemen's Association has something out back for everybody afterwards. So I invite everybody to attend. I hope they do attend. I hope anybody that wants to march in parade, we don't exclude anybody. Nope. If you want to march, come on down. You can march
more
with
the merrier.
Us.
You can sometimes some years you can even push Will Sillen's truck down the road.
Someday you can push Will Sillen's truck, and one of the things that we do, and Tom Zimnoski is usually there to film it, but I always think it's a poignant memory is when we read the role of those from Sunderland that have gone off and have not come back. And it's a very poignant, the laying of the carnations at the flag. And if you haven't been, I think it's you'd be it's a and the tolling of the bell that was donated after the passing of Mr. White. So if you have the time, come on down.
Yeah.
It doesn't take long. You're over by 7 o'clock, and it's a good time. Anything else?
Mr. Chair, there's been road work on Cemetery Road, which is just wide enough to be fast, just flat enough to be fast, just straight enough to be fast. Just ask people to slow down and pay attention. And if you're a pedestrian or a biker down there, the cars are a lot quieter than they used to be.
Yeah.
Pay attention down there. There's been a fair amount of consternation about people hustling. Frankly, I have no idea why you want to drive through a cornfield toward a cemetery at such light speed, but apparently somebody's got to do it. So slow down, drivers. Pay attention, everybody else.
Okay. Anything else?
Nope.
I'll entertain a motion.
A motion to adjourn?
Second.
Absolutely. Motion made and seconded. Any other discussion? All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Sherry, we shall be out at 7:34. Mr. Collins, thank you very much once again.